Okay. Hello and good morning, everyone. Welcome to the to this forum. So this forum topic is the challenges of the abolitionist movement. Hi, everyone. So I'm Ira. I'm the office manager for ADPAN. Today, I'll be conducting this, moderating this forum for this morning. So this forum will be conducted in two languages, English and Mandarin. So for those who just joined, feel free to choose your own preferred language at the interpretation button at the bottom of your screen. And as for today, we have our two panelists, which is Mr. Chiu Xin Chiu. I'm sorry if I didn't get to pronounce your name correctly, and Ms. Kasthuri Patto, the members of parliament of Batu Kawan from Malaysia. And we also have Lin Xin Yi, the executive director for TAEDP, who will do the who will be the speaker for our sharing session today. Okay. So before we begin, as a house rule, please keep your microphone muted at all times, and you are encouraged to switch on your camera to make the forum livelier. And also, if you have any question, please use the raise hand raise button, and also you may type your question in the chat box below. We will open Q&A, question and answer session, after all the panelists have spoken, after all the question has been raised. So you will have your chance to ask your question to all the speakers. Okay, so without further ado, I'll do a brief introduction of our speaker for today. The first one, we have Mr. Chiu Xin Chiu. He is a Taiwanese lawyer and a politician. He contested in the 2016 and 2020 legislative elections as a member of the New Power Party and winning the latter election. Mr. Chiu served as a leader of the New Power Party between March and August 2019 and was reappointed to the role in an acting capacity in August 2020. The next speaker would be Ms. Kasthuri Patto. Her Honorable Kasthuri Patto is a Malaysian politician from the Democratic Action Party. In 2013, Ms. Kasthuri was elected as a Malaysian Member of Parliament of the P46 Batu Kawan constituency in Penang. Throughout her career, she remains an ardent supporter of human rights and advocates for the abolition of the death penalty, gender issues, racial discrimination, and many more critical issues after her constituents and the country. Apart from the exemplary work as a member of parliament, she has campaigned tirelessly on social justice causes and against the death penalty in Malaysia and beyond. She was also nominated to be the H14 Influential Asian Woman Shaping a More Inclusive Global Society. Okay, to begin with the sharing session, I will pass this floor to Xin Yi. Thank you.
大家好，我是台湾废除死刑推动联盟的执行长。那同时，当初亚洲反死刑网络 ADPAN 成立的时候，那我以及那个台湾废死联盟，我们也是刚开始的一个创始成员之一。那同时，我们现在也是世界反死刑网络的成员 ，World Coalition Against the Death Penalty。所以跟那个卡苏里 也见过面，然后跟ADPAN 我们有很好的互动。那我们为什么会这次想要来举办这样的线上座谈？因为基本上已经是我们在十月份世界反死刑日以来今天是第三场，然后也是最后的一场啊。那我们会想要做这样子的一个合作是一方面过去我们台湾事实上我们跟马来西亚的废死运动者我们有很多的互动，那也看到你们非常的努力。那在过去一样马来西亚的废死运动者也对台湾有很多的支持，那我们可能面临到的困境是类似的，所以我们今天才会选择一个主题叫做民主、民意跟废死运动的困境来一起讨论哦。那尤其是我觉得我们遇到的困难会很相似，就是 可能我们的政治人物可能都会以民意不支持死刑作为一个借口。那在台湾我们很时常遇到的状况可能会是说啊，你看美国也还有死刑，然后日本也还有死刑。那我相信在马来西亚可能也会有这种说法，就会说哦，好像某一些国家也还有死刑啊，那为什么我们马来西亚要废除，或者是为什么台湾要废除死刑啊？那所以我们因为今年的世界反死刑日，我们废死联盟我们就整理了在电子报上面，我们就整理了一些亚洲国家的发展。那我们当然是觉得说在过去废死联盟在2003年成立的时候，那时候我就在废死联盟了。那在那个时候成立的时候，我们的确受到很多欧洲国家的经验的影响，尤其是我相信大家都知道今年是法国废除死刑的40周年，所以我印象很深刻，在2003年我们开始在做废死运动的时候，那我们开始在那个比如说举办读书会或做讨论的时候，法国的确给我们了很大的影响，那当然一直到现在 也都还是。那尤其那时候法国的前法务部长，就是带领法国废除死刑的法务部长巴丹戴尔的故事，可能给了我们很多很多的这个启发。可是台湾人就会问说，可是那个是欧洲，那欧洲可能是一个比较先进民主人权的国家，那台湾还不到这个时候，台湾的民意是支持死刑的。那再加上可能日本跟美国可能是台湾很时常参照的国家，都还有死刑，所以大家就比较不愿意去做这个讨论。那等一下我很期待听到马来西亚的状况是怎么样，因为我相信在民意的这个部分可能我们还是一样有同样的说法。可是我觉得在台湾我们的经验是台湾过去当然大家都知道我们历经了很长的一段时间的集权政党的一个统治，那在2000年的时候我们才第一次的政党轮替，第一次的比较接近民主转型的时刻。那那个时候是一个很好的机会，就是台湾那时候的总统说台湾要废除死刑，要逐步的废除死刑，那一直到之后也有这样子的一个政策目标，可是当然还是有执行死刑，但是至少是在政策上往这个方向努力。那在2006年到2009年的时候，台湾有四年的时间停止死刑执行，那一直到2010年的时候又重启了死刑的执行那这是我们的一个过程。可是可能跟马来西亚比较不一样的地方是，虽然我们不是联合国的成员，台湾的国家的那个地位可能在国际上是比较特殊的，我们不是联合国的成员，可是在2009年的时候我们通过了一个两公约的施行法，就是ICCPR 以及 ICESCR 两个公约的施行法，那让这两个国际公约国内法化。那这也是我之前才学习到，好像马来西亚是在签署公约上面好像是还没有的，但等一下可能我可以 听到多一点。可是因为ICCPR 的这个签署至少成为台湾的国内法之后，那台湾就至少要往废除死刑作为一个目标是我们的国家的义务。那所以台湾废死联盟我们在这个倡议的过程当中，当然我们可以以国际公约我们已经成为国内法作为我们的一个主要的诉求。可是你可以发现在这个过程当中，一方面他们虽然说我们会遵守我们的在签署公约之后我们的国家责任，政府或者政治人物，可是一方面他们每次遇到了一个比较比如说有一些政治上面的压力的时候，他们又倾向于用死刑执行来转移这个焦点所以对我们来讲是非常非常困难的一个状况，就是你有四年停止死刑执行是2006年到2009年，可是之后几乎每年都有死刑的执行，而且通常都是为了回应所谓的这个民意的要求。那个时候废死联盟我们开始就理解到一件事情，就是我们在做的事情我相信跟你们在马来西亚做的事情是很类似的，我们针对个案的部分重大刑事案件有可能会被判死刑的个案，我们会组成律师团救援他们。那邱显智立法委员，他现在是立法委员，但他在过去是律师的时候，我们那时候有很多的合作。 那后来当然大家在做的可能死刑冤案的救援，在台湾我们可能如果比起马来西亚有一点进展的话，就我所知我们有一些死刑冤案的平反，但马来西亚在这个部分是比较困难的。那一样的显示也跟我合作过一个案件，就是郑醒泽案的一个救援。那另外我们当然要做的是政治上面的倡议，然后社会上面的这个对话，我相信我们做的工作都很相近。可是在政治上面的这个倡议事实上是非常非常困难的哦。所以我们怎么做呢？我们在2013年2014年的时候我们做了一个比较大规模的民意调查。那这个民意调查说实在的，在过去台湾每次有重大刑事案件发生的时候，有时候就会有电视台或报纸会用电话访问的方式打电话去问说你支不支持死刑，那通常就是一个问题或两个问题，那大部分在那个时候都会很愤怒，都会说哎，我支持死刑。可是我们2013年2014年跟中研院合作的这个调查计划，我们想要知道的是，对，可能很多人是支持死刑的，但是他为什么支持死刑，以及在什么样的状况下他会选择不要死刑，但是选择其他的死刑替代方案。所以我们那一年做出来的结果就会是说，如果那时候是一个访问2000多个人的面对面的访谈，而且那题目很长，大概有104道题目，所以他可以做很多的分析。那在那个时候我们访谈的结果就会发现说，如果人民有更多对于死刑的知识，包括说死刑的执行方式，死刑有可能误判，我们的司法判决可能没有那么的公正的状态之下的话，你有越来越多的死刑的知识，或者是对于公约、国际人权公约标准的知识的话，你就会比较倾向于不要有死刑。然后我们也问了，就是说好，那如果有死刑的替代方案，例如终身监禁不得假释，然后受刑人必须要在监狱中工作，工作的所得必须要赔偿被害者家属，这个作为死刑的替代方案的话，你就会发现有 71% 的受访民众会支持这样的方案。那或者是我们问说，如果是无期徒刑但是25年之后有假释的机会，那这个25年之后有假释机会是现在台湾除了死刑之外最严厉的刑罚，那同时我们的再犯率很低，然后如果是这样的话，你同意不要有死刑而用无期徒刑25年可以假释作为替代方案吗？结果我们发现基本上支持死刑跟支持25年可以假释的人比例是差不多的，几乎都有快到 50% 的比例，那强烈反对人非常非常的少。意思就是说，我觉得每一个民众他都有一个质朴的正义感，因此他觉得死刑可能是一个正义的表现。可是当我们给他一个复杂的选项，给他一个其他可能的方式的时候，你就会发现说人民的正义感是非常复杂的。我举例，刚才有 71% 的人支持终身监禁不得假释，但是受刑人必须要在监狱中工作，工作所得必须要赔偿被害者家属，因此你可以看到人民是希望犯罪者受到惩罚，同时他希望他们在监狱里面要自己付出那个劳力去养活自己，他们不需要纳税人的钱养坏人，同时他们也关切到犯罪被害人的这个补偿是重要的。那可是我们的政治人物怎么做？我们的政治人物通常都用一个非常简单的方式去回应说，哦，那因为民众支持死刑，所以我必须要维持死刑。但是他们看不到民众的支持死刑或者还希望维持死刑，他们是有比较复杂的一个原因，以及他们是可以被改变的。那我们在努力的方向就是说，如何的让政治人物可以去改变。好，那这个如何改变，或许我们等一下可以有很多的讨论，尤其是我们今天有两位的立法委员国会议员来到现场，或许他们可能也可以有一些的分享。但是基本上我们最近刚做了一个研究，但是这个研究结果还没有正式发表，我们正在翻译哦。它的结果也还是一样，就是政治人物跟人民是一样的，他必须要有更多的相关的知识，他才有可能去选择不要死刑，否则他还是会觉得说好像死刑是有帮助的。当然我觉得刚才大家提到的是不是因为选举的关系，所以大家不倾向特别谈死刑这个议题，当然也是有的。 可是真的也牵涉到说，很多的立法委员可能对于死刑、对于死刑的冤案、对于死刑司法制度的这个不公平的危险性，可能是不那么的了解的。好，这是我想分享的其中的一个部分。那另外呢，我还剩下一点点的时间，我也很想跟大家谈两个例子，因为我们都每次都说美国跟日本还维持死刑，然后欧洲的例子离我们太远了，这不是我们能够参照的。我相信可能在马来西亚也会讲说，我们马来西亚有马来西亚的状况，或者是我们亚洲有亚洲的这个价值。可是我想特别跟大家提出来的事情是，因为基本上我们也是亚洲反死刑网络的成员，我们就会希望说大家可以看看另外两个比较近的例子，一个是韩国，一个是蒙古。那韩国当然目前它还是有死刑的状况，但是它从1997年年底最后一次死刑执行之后，一直到现在已经有20几年都是停止死刑执行的状况。那我记得我们曾经在2008年的时候，我们 Face 联盟到那个韩国去做访问，我们派了一组我们的年轻的这个特派员，年轻的学生，他们到韩国去做访问，然后他们也访问到了韩国的大学生以及一般的民众，就是问他们，你就会发现他们就说，他们的确在他们懂事以来，韩国就是一个没有执行死刑的国家，因此对他们来讲好像死刑并不是一件很重要的事情。那你可以看到就是说，韩国停止死刑执行二十几年来，当然在过去有时候在发生重大案件的时候，总是会有人说是不是要恢复死刑，可是看样子到目前为止大概很难，我相信很难，就是他们在恢复死刑的这个执行。那甚至我觉得过去联合国在每几年他们可能都会有一个那个停止死刑执行的一个决议，就是 moratorium 的一个决议。那在过去韩国都是可能不表达意见，可是在2020年的这一次的这个联合国的 UNGA 的决议上面，南韩终于投下了赞成票。所以我觉得这也是一个非常重要的一个给我们的一个启发，就是停止死刑执行作为很多国家废除死刑的一个步骤的话，那就台湾来说，我也很希望说我们可以回到2006年2009年的那个状况，在停止死刑执行的状况下去检讨台湾我们目前要怎么走以及相关的一个措施。那另外一个我也想要举个例子，就是蒙古作为一个例子，是我相信蒙古是一个很标准的例子哦。我记得我们是在2014年的时候，Face 联盟我们也是去访问了蒙古哦。那因为那时候我们知道的讯息是2010年的时候，那时候的蒙古总统他当选总统之后，他就宣布了他要暂停死刑执行。然后随后他在2012年的时候，蒙古的国会就批准了公民与政治权利国际公约的第二任责议定书 ,ICCPR 的第二任责议定书。那这就是一个在国际上面废除死刑的一个法案。然后2015年的时候，他就通过了一个新修正的刑法，就是说蒙古的最严重的一个刑罚是无期徒刑。然后法律上死刑条文的正式废除是2017年7月。所以蒙古成为第105个废除死刑的国家。那我为什么说它是一个好像很标准的一个过程，是他们先停止死刑，宣布停止死刑执行，后来通过了第二任责议定书，后来在法律上面废止。那我们那时候去问的时候，是在过去在讨论废除死刑的时候，蒙古的国会议员是强烈反对废除死刑，支持死刑的一个状态。可是当2010年蒙古这位总统他上任之后，他虽然说宣布停止死刑执行，可是他并不是只有口头上这样宣誓而已。那我们在2014年的访问的时候，我们发现他花了很多的力气去做政党的协调，去做司法包括跟司法系统去做协调，去跟他们说明说为什么蒙古需要废除死刑。所以一直到2012年这个签署第二任责议定书的时候，蒙古是跨党派多数决的方式通过了这个议案。 所以你可以看到2010年到2012年、哦、就是他必须要有政治人物愿意去做这些沟通，愿意去跟大家说为什么蒙古需要废除死刑。然后印象当中他们有一个、说法是说蒙古的人太少了，蒙古的每一条人命都非常的重要。那我们那时候去蒙古的时候很可惜我们没有、没有遇到那个、那时候他到联合国去演讲，所以我们没有遇到总统，可是我们几乎遇到了政府所有政府里面的、成员，那包括各政党的人物，然后包括媒体，然后包括民间团体，所以、那时候我们是很全面性的了解了他们的状况。那同时他们也提到了一件事情，就是说蒙古也是历经一个、就是集权统治然后民主转型的这个过程，所以在这个过程当中我觉得跟台湾的2000年的状况是一样的。那他们把握了这个机会，然后、了解到了如果政府握有死刑的这个权利的话是一个、非常危险的一个状态，那所以我觉得在那个时候他们就、往下做了这个决定。所以我会觉得就是以台湾或者是以马来西亚来说，我觉得我们要看到，当然、我们要关注国内的一个状况，但是同时我们也要关注到国际的发展。那对我来说在、亚洲的发展来讲，蒙古或者是那个韩国就是我们最好的一个、参照。那说起来今年十月份我也写了一篇文章，我就在想说那我们最不能够去那个参照的一个国家大概就是中国了、哦、因为中国的那个状况，如果我们那时候我们还请了就是那个、中国的维权律师滕彪帮我们写了一篇中国死刑的一个状况的一个分析，那一样的他的死刑执行是非常的多的，但是他并不是一个治安很好的国家，甚至他有很多很多的这个问题。那日本的状况也是嘛，日本还有死刑，但是也有很多废死运动者在努力当中。那日本的这个废死运动者也说请马来西亚或者请台湾的这些国家也不要觉得说因为日本有死刑就觉得怎么样，因为他们在死刑的这个议题上面事实上他们是非常落后跟保守的一个状态的。那台湾我自己觉得我们有进步，因为我们的死刑的判决跟死刑的执行是越来越少的。那怎么达成这个目标，是我们透过我们做律师的训练，然后也跟法官检察官做对话，也做训练，所以我们在这几年来的死刑的判决几乎是零个到一个，那死刑的执行也是非常非常少的一个状态。那这是我们进步的一个方向，但是同时我们也在努力，就是如何的跟公众对话，所以我们花了很多的力气可能做全台湾各县市的公民审议。可是我必须要说，即便民间团体我们再怎么努力，或者是在马来西亚的民间团体再怎么努力，但是如果不让政治人物理解为什么要废除死刑，以及让他们承担他们应该作为政治人物应该要有的作为的话，然后像我们，我觉得在像韩国或蒙古这样子政治人物就是应该要承担一定的责任的话，如果不这样子做的话，当然废除死刑的努力会越来越少。所以对我们来讲，我们作为一个民间的团体，我们会尽量的做，但是我们除了做社会倡议，除了做大众倡议之外，我真的觉得在政治上面的倡议也是非常非常的重要的，那这也是我们应该要一起努力的。因此我才会希望说我们邀请到两位国会议员可能来跟我们分享他们的一个想法。那我想我的二十分钟就到此为止，我希望之后我们还有更多的讨论，谢谢大家，谢谢。
Thank you very much, Xinyi, for such a very informative sharing. Along the sharing just now, there were few questions raised. One of it about how Malaysia hasn't rectified the ICCPR. So maybe YB Kasthuri wants to address that question first.
Thank you, Xinyi, to Ira from ADPAN for the invitation to join in and to speak about this important subject today, a very timely subject to be addressed. And especially a big thanks to Ivy for the translation. So as what Xinyi had mentioned, Malaysia has not ratified some of the important international conventions pertaining to human rights. To date, we have ratified the Convention on the Rights of the Child. We have ratified CEDAW. We have ratified Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. And some other conventions on money laundering, on trafficking at sea, etc., or violations at sea. But when it comes to this sort of a very important subject, particularly on human rights, there has been a bit of a hesitancy, a resistance. And I think it is largely to do with when a government makes an announcement or when the subject and the topic comes up, then you find that the conservatives or rather the extremists tend to take over the narrative of how this subject or how this topic is then conveyed to the man or the woman on the street. And then you find that there is a use of the siege mentality. They always look at the situation with the glass half full, half empty, in a sense that, oh, what happens if we ratify these sort of international conventions? And they start speaking about the royalty, how it would affect the king, whether race or religion will be implicated in this or not. And this defeats the purpose because the subject is on human rights. But when they bring in these sort of emotional arguments, then the entire subject is then diverted. There's a sort of an uncertainty or fear in the hearts of the people. And as what Sinyi rightfully pointed out, many legislators and lawmakers are not in touch with this sort of human rights issue. I must go back to the 2018 election. Now, let's not forget that Malaysia has not seen a change of government since independence in 1957. We have had the same political parties in power. We have had, and in 2018, it is the courage and the conscience of the people that woke up and said, no, we've had enough. After 60 years, we need to have a change of regime. And so we must understand that for 60 years, human rights ideas have never been challenged as much as it is being spoken about and challenged today. Human rights issues were always associated with Western concepts, Western ideas, and Malaysia by default looks at itself as Islam being the religion of the federation. Many very easily use the phrase Malaysia as an Islamic state, and therefore this sort of concept of human rights and freedom, equality and justice are often equated to liberalization and very progressive ideas, you know. And that's the sort of fear-mongering that has happened over the years. And also the idea of how would domestic laws then come into play when an international treaty or a convention on human rights is then signed and ratified. There's always a sort of fear. How will we be bound by it? You know, will Malaysia be ever taken to court for it? How would our kings be then put at the dragged to court, etc.? This is what the opposition normally plays up. Tying that to the subject of the death penalty, I'm always very curious when I hear about polls being conducted about the death penalty. And this idea actually struck me when I was in Oslo for the Anti-Death Penalty Congress. It dawned to me because at that time Malaysia was just, we had just received a report conducted by Roger Hood, and the Attorney General's Chambers was actually going through this very detailed report and trying to crunch the numbers and to simplify the report. What was the sentiment, feeling, emotions of the Malaysian public as far as the death penalty is concerned through various questions? And that was also the time that the country was in its second year after the implementation of the Goods and Services Tax, which came as a shock to everyone. After the election, the government said, oh, we're going to introduce this 6% goods and services tax. And we were like, oh, we didn't know about this at all. And it just suddenly hit us in Parliament. Why I'm saying this is there was no study, online poll, offline poll, face-to-face poll, survey conducted on how the public is going to accept or receive or understand this 6% increase of goods and services tax. Never has a government conducted a poll when they wanted to introduce or increase tax on its people. Never. If at all a small government agency will just do, you know, like a sort of a, just to feel the sentiment, the anger of the people or how people understand the text. But either way, governments go ahead with it and you learn to adjust. you learn to adjust with this increase of tax or introduction of the new tax. But the death penalty is always a victim of these online polls. It's always a victim of a survey, etc. Now, one interesting takeaway from the Congress in Oslo was presented by a lecturer from Japan. And she said, there's just simply no way that anyone can conduct a poll on the death penalty by asking, do you support the death penalty, yes or no? Do you think the country should keep the death penalty, yes or no? As Sinyi mentioned, it was 100 questions that they had asked in a survey of 2,000 people. And I think that's the way forward, if at all we want to get public opinion. But again, the death penalty has always been a subject also that governments don't want to get their hands dirty with. They always want to tai chi the problem, tai chi the issue back to the people and say, oh, the people have spoken, so we have to follow that, and therefore we are going to keep the death penalty. But if the people rise and say, we don't want this tax, will governments then also take that immediate knee-jerk reaction and say, okay, we're going to withdraw this tax? You know, many times riots and loss of lives and damage to public property has resulted in governments reviewing taxes, let alone abolishing it or reducing it, etc. So I think I think that it's a slippery slope to be always engaging with on public opinion, just like referendums that's done on Brexit, how long it dragged just because there was a referendum back and forth. When you have a misinformed public or an ill-informed public, how do you then conduct a poll where you're supposed to yield answers, but you end up explaining to them? I think there should be a separate campaign just on explaining about the death penalty rather than moving into a poll and then, because again, there are not many people who are on board on the subject of the death penalty. I did raise this point on Malaysia ratifying these international human rights conventions in my budget speech, and I hope the minister would have taken note of it and would give me a favorable answer. Also, perhaps I would like to share, I've been informed that among with other MPs, I am in the Parliamentary Select Committee on Foreign Affairs, which means I think this will give me a bigger and a greater platform. Perhaps as a pressure point to the government to remind them of countries like Taiwan that has signed and ratified these important treaties, and Malaysia being a new member in the UN Human Rights Council, I think it is right that the next step would be to sign and ratify these sort of international conventions. We don't want to be seen as a country that is just a token seat that we have received. Malaysia must walk the talk. When we have been given this privilege among many countries at a seat at the UN Human Rights Council, I think this is the best platform to form alliances with other countries and partnerships and networks so that we can learn and get best practices from these countries, abolitionist countries perhaps, if non-abolitionist countries, and Malaysia can act as the middleman between these countries. Now, come back to the Malaysian scenario here. We have not had executions, I believe, since 2016 or 17. But in 2018, in October, the then Minister of Law, the late Liu Wui-kyong, took it upon himself and said that he wants to move towards Malaysia abolishing the death penalty. But there was a lot of, after an announcement like that has been made, then the government must prepare the narrative and package the subject properly for a smooth transition from what a government announces until it reaches the ears of the people. We were in government, but I think some of the flaws of the government at that time when we were in power was that we didn't utilize that space properly. So it was hijacked by conservatives and extremists who said, you know, who didn't capitalize, and you know, they rounded up all the victims of particularly murder victims' families, you know, very emotional, everybody's crying, and the lawyers are all saying, what about them? What about their voices? And that triggers a very strong emotion.
I think we have some technical difficulties. Let's go check back with Ms. Kasthuri. Okay, while waiting for YB Kasthuri to join us again, maybe we can get Mr. Chiu Sinchi to do some sharing on the topic for today. And then when Mr. YB Kasthuri, once she joins again, then we can continue with her after this.
这样可以吗 ？OK， 啊 ，Dobby、心仪以及 Three 哈，还有这个线上的朋友，大家早安，大家好。那非常荣幸能够在这边跟大家分享一些在台湾哈，不管是从过去的辩护，以及现在在国会里面的一些针对废除死刑议题的一些经验呐哈。那因为我自己作为一个律师哈，那在过去的这个，应该是说。不管是说帮一些死刑的案件辩护，或者是说在这个从事一些冤案的救援，然后那当然那个冤案救援里面，其实有一些是这个并没有涉及到死刑的，因为涉及到死刑的案件毕竟比较少。但是当有一些涉及到死刑的案件，像刚刚心里提到的郑信哲案，或者是说这个其他的这一些案件的时候，你就会发现说，哇，这个。死刑的这个制度是一个非常非常严重的一个问题，因为当你认为说这个案件他被判死刑，那他事实上是有疑虑的，比如说这个被判死刑的人可能是无辜的，那在这个情况之下的时候，你会面对到一个问题，就是说那会不会你救援到一半的时候根本就还没有办法帮他平反他的冤屈，帮这个无辜者平反的冤屈的时候，那他已经被这个执行死刑了，那执行死刑的问题就是说他的这个特殊之处就是在于说人死不能复生嘛，当一个人死了之后你要怎么让他能够活过来，这是不可能的事情。那其实在台湾在过去也有这个被判死刑的案件，然后他被执行了，他人已经在监狱里面，然后就被枪杀了之后，结果这个过了许多年之后发现，原来他是一个无辜的人，然后判他无罪，就是像江国庆案。但是问题是说这个判他无罪之后，江国庆已经死了，那这个状况当然就是大家所不能够接受的。所以其实我在这个当律师的时候，因为一方面自己亲身的经历，我在这个律师工会或者是很多律师的这个集合，台湾律师的这个参会也好，或者是说在律师工会的律师休息室大家在等庭的时候，那我通常都会去跟一些资深的律师然后聊天嘛，因为 在律师休息室里面等庭大家都很无聊，或者是在法庭外面大家聊天的时候，你会发现说其实台湾的律师尤其是在办刑事案件的律师对死刑这个制度本身都是非常的保留，或者是大多数都是非常怀疑的。为什么？因为律师实在太清楚的了解到说这个判决是怎么产生的。那就像其实刚刚这个 Kasthuri 跟这个心理都有提到，因为是人在判不是这个神在判，所以人在判他难免就会有判错，那这个判错不管是刑事案件、死刑案件、不是死刑案件、民事的案件，或者是说涉及到行政法的案件，各种类型你只要是审判，那就有可能会出错。所以在这个情况之下，当然你要非常谨慎，就是说如果这个刑种像死刑，他判下去之后，那如果万一真的判错了，那判错了之后人死不能复生，那不能够回来，这怎么办？那所以就这是部分的话，作为一个律师，然后去对这个死刑制度持比较保留的意见，我觉得这个是应该是说是一个比较普遍的，或者是说比较自然的一个状况，好，那第二个层次就是讲到说，当如果发生一个 非常严重的刑案的时候，我曾经到一些地方去演讲，我印象最深刻的是说我到一个国小演讲，那一个国小演讲的时候，我也会问这些小学生说，那如果有一个人很坏很坏很坏很坏，坏到无比的坏，坏到不行，那做了一个非常伤天害理的事情，就是一个非常惨绝人寰的一个案件，比如说把另外一个人杀了或怎么样的话，那你们会不会认为说我们就是应该把这一个人这个杀掉然后去让他这个一命抵一命就是让他付出代价。结果我非常惊讶的这些小学生的回答，有的人是说我觉得好像不太妥当，那我就问他说，那为什么你会觉得这样不太妥当？他的说法是说，这个小朋友的说法是说，哎，那也许可能不是他干的你要确定说是不是干的，有可能会弄错。我说哇，竟然还会有这样的想法，然后就是说有可能会弄错。好，那第二个又有一个小朋友问那个回答是说，哎，我觉得不太好。他说，我说为什么你会觉得不太好？他说，坏人也可能会有好的一面呐、啊。哦，小朋友他非常的直觉是这样回。我说，哎呦，怎么会有这样的想法？我们的想法就是说，这个人很坏很坏很坏，坏到无比的坏的，坏到百分之百的坏。哦，然后他就说，不对不对，其实应该坏的人也应该有好的一面的、啊、哈、哦。所以就这部分的话，我自己也会深受到冲击。哦，那第三个部分就是在国会里面，通常大家面对的就是说，因为有一个背景就是说，台湾在这个2016年完这个第二次政党轮替，2016年之前是这个国民党的马英九政府执政。那当时我在当律师的时候，跟心仪一起在面对很多的这些案件的时候，我觉得国民党政府最令人没办法接受的状况就是他操作一个叫做死刑政治。我不知道说在马来西亚或其他国家的政治人物有没有这个状况，简单讲就是说，当这个国家的民调这个执政党的民调，当时的马英九政府的民调因为各种原因它比较下降的时候，那他就会操作一个叫做死刑政治。简单讲就是说，他透过他的国会的立法委员，那他就提出来说，当这个民调下降的时候，他就在国会的议员，通常那个议员就是吴育生啦，这其实大家都知道，他就在国会里面讲说啊，台湾很久没有执行死刑了、啊、怎么样怎么样之类的。好，接下来的某一个星期五，政府就会配合然后杀掉几个人，那杀掉几个人之后，转移这个政府的焦点，或者是说让这个民意认为说，哇，这个政府有在做事等等之类的。所以基本上他在执行死刑，在马英九时代他在执行死刑，他就是通常在一个他的民意的危机的时候，然后用这样的方式希望能够把他的民意支持度拉回来。所以我们是认为说这个是非常恶劣的一个部分，就是说这个死刑的执行与否存在是一个政治上的考量，那政治利益的考量。那2016年之后，这个民进党政府上台，那其实民进党政府在过去在野的时候，其实对这个死刑的这个制度基本上也是持保留的态度的。那2016年之后，确实然后比起过去的马英九政府，第一个就是说执行死刑，应该我如果印象没错的话，应该执行死刑的这个案件好像到目前为止只有一件。那当然就是像刚刚心仪讲的，台湾现在的判死刑的这个案件也比较少。不过呢，基本上我认为民党政府对死刑的这个议题还是非常的这个小心翼翼的，主要是说这个涉及到的这个民意调查或者是等等这样的状况，他们都会认为说，哎，这个民调显示有大多数的人是不赞成这个废除死刑的。那其实就像刚刚心仪讲的，有这个原因到底是什么，有没有去进一步的去问说，好，那如果我这个执行这个死刑废除改用终身监禁或其他的方式去替代的时候，那到底你赞不赞成？那我那 其实有一个民调就显示说五成二的民众是赞成这个死刑废除是在有这个终身监禁作为替代的情况之下的，所以并不是说在任何情况之下这问法然后答案都是所谓的多数人的意见，这根本上的原因应该是在说你对于这个配套措施应该是怎么去处理的问题。那去年在台湾的审判制度有一个很大很大的改变，然后就是开始引进了所谓的国民法官法。国民法官法的意思就是说这个在十年以上有期徒刑的案件，然后包括这个死刑的案件，基本上它将来是会有一个所谓的国民法官跟这个一般职业的法官本来的法官一起来这个审判，叫做合审合判，就是说三位的这个法官跟六位的国民法官，国民法官就是一般的民众一起进来审判。那在这个就是协商的过程之中，等于是说在这个法要通过的时候，本来它的规定是说死刑它是国民法官和职业法官过半数决定就好了。那我们当时跟包括心理跟其他的团体，我们的主张就是认为说哇，这个事情是一个死刑是一个非常严重的事情，那它涉及到说如果万一这个做错了决定的话，它没办法再回复，所以就这部分的话不应该说只有这个过半数的决定就好，所以那时候就去跟大家去说服是不是能够用三分之二作为一个多数决的门槛。那最后其实大家也能够同意啦，因为就是其他党派的委员最后也决定说是用三分之二的方式去把它做一个折中，这样子就是说包含了国民法官跟这个法官双方的意见必须要三分之二以上同意，然后才能够这个判决实行，等于是说这个门槛并不是过半数，而是说要到达三分之二。那这当然就是说这个让死刑的这个判决啦，让死刑的判决能够更加的谨慎，就这个部分。那最后我要讲一个就是说我们常常会去设想一个状况，我刚刚举的例子就是说你如果去真的去调查台湾的刑事律师的话，你会发现说对死刑制度持有保留意见的人啊，恐怕是占多数。好，那为什么现在的状况看起来这个政治人物所设想的这个民意的大多数是反对废除死刑？我觉得这个涉及到刚刚第一个问题，就是说你怎么问的问题，第二个是说这一些生命的经验，生命的经验恐怕还是一个重点，就是说一般的台湾民众他没有接触法院的经验，或者是说他不知道说这个法院的判决，法院的判决到底他做出来的程序是什么，他离这个法院的判决事实上是非常非常远的。那我觉得就是说第一个 我自己的想法是觉得说这个国民法官制，就是说从去年开始到现在的国民法官制，除了我们把这个判决死刑的门槛从二分之一然后我们把它推进到三分之二之外，我觉得重点是说应该要让这个国民法官的制度能够让更多的案件可以适用，也就是说他现在的规定是十年以上有期徒刑之罪无期徒刑到死刑，然后他这所能够适用的案件每年大概才五六百件，那如果你以一个案件是这个六个人啊，就是国民法官这三加六嘛，一个案件大概是国民法官是六个人的话，那能够进入到这个法庭里面去真正参与这个审判的这个民众基本上大概才三千多人，那我觉得这样的状况是远远不及的啦，就是应该是你要让民众能够多多的接近 法庭的实务，相信他们会对包括这个死刑的案件或者是说冤错案的案件有不一样的看法，所以我觉得国民法官制能够 拉低那个门槛，不是说十年以上，可能你变成七年以上，甚至说三年以上有期徒刑之罪，你就可以加入，这可能是一个比较好的方法。那最后一个我要补充的就是说，台湾在思考死刑案件的时候，可能要跟马来西亚还有一个或其他国家有一个更多的一个侧重点，一个点必须要去思考。那个参考的基数应该是香港，因为香港它在这个什么时候废除死刑，香港是在1993年的时候废除死刑。那香港为什么1993年的时候过去在英国统治的时候它有死刑的制度，但是在1993年这个时间点香港决定废除死刑，因为再过四年就是1997年、哦、那1997之后没有人知道这个中国这个统治下的香港、哦、这个是什么样的状况。果然你看在2019年的反送中运动，你可以知道说现在已经没有所谓的1997年所保证的一国两制的、哦、那在1997之后的香港，大家不知道说这个国家权力，尤其是新来的统治者，他会做出什么样的状况之下，他在1993年这个废除死刑、哦、那跟其实这个是一个政治上的考量，跟在德国、哦、德国你可以看到在1945年之后、哦、在这个1948年的这个波昂基本法的时候，德国宪法制定的时候，他直接在基本法，在德国宪法102条直接废除死刑。为什么？因为他就是一个政治上的考量，认为说假使未来这个德国的这个领导人又产生了像希特勒的这样的一个领导人的时候，哇，那 这个是一个多么恐怖的 事情。你可以知道说1933年到1945年在这个纳粹的集中营或者是说德国的各式各样的监狱里面死了多少人、哦、所以就这个部分的话是基于说对政治权威的不信赖，对统治者的这个不信赖，所以这个战后所成立的波昂基本法它直接就废除了死刑、哦、所以就这个部分的话，其实台湾在思考这个死刑制度的时候应该、哦、要跟其他的国家也要能够加入这种是不是、哦、这个政治上的考量、哦、就是说对于这个统治者、哦、对于这个外来的威胁，然后这个的不信赖、哦、那因此而对这个死刑制度必须要有所保留的这个状况、哦、那最后讲一点就是说我在德国的经验、啊、以我在这个德国读书六七年的经验，我觉得德国是一个没有死刑的国家、哦、然后不管是在德国啦，像欧洲刚刚心仪也有提到法国在1981年的时候废除死刑，那其实你可以看到说德国瑞士或者是说这些欧洲其他的国家，它是一个没有死刑的国家，但是它的治安、哦、它的这个犯罪率比台湾低非常非常多、哦、因为我有时候会跟我的在德国认识的这个律师的朋友或者是说瑞士的这个律师稍微有一些联系有一些讨论、哦、瑞士在监狱的人数、哦、才7000人，瑞士的律师几乎找不到刑事案件可以办、哦、那德国的状况也是一样，就是说德国8000多万人，但是事实上他在监的人数比在台湾的这个在监狱的人数还少、哦、所以死刑是不是一个这个社会治安的决定的因素？应该不是、哦、死刑的存在与否不是一个社会治安的存在的因素，否则的话这一些没有死刑的欧洲国家它的治安应该要非常坏对还才对，但是相反的这些欧洲国家它的这个死刑、早就已经废除了，但是它的社会治安非常的良好、哦、那反而是说你如果从另外一个角度、哦、在欧洲很多的监狱里面、哦、他执行一种制度就是让这些这个囚犯、哦、这些收容人他可以自己的养一只狗、哦、那为什么他们会有这种做法，就是说他们认为说这一些收容人为什么他会去做犯罪、哦、去做这一些伤人或者是说侵害别人的行为，就是因为他没有被爱、哦、所以他开始在监狱里面在收容所里面让他养一只狗，因为狗可以对 狗对人类的这个爱是全心全意的、哦、那当他养这一只狗开始，他就可以从跟这一只狗的互动里面、哦、长出了这个爱人的这个力量、哦、然后开始，然后根据调查就是说，他这些人出狱之后他的再犯率是非常非常低的。所以你可以知道是说，如果我们要让一个社会，或者是说让一个就是这个犯罪的人，他未来他减低他的这个犯罪率的话，那真正最需要的可能是要让他可以、哦、能够是不是能够在一个体系里面能够让他可以长出更重新的长出这个爱人的这个力量、哦、所以就这个部分的话是其实才是非常非常重要的。那这个刚刚心里有提到说，其实大部分的民众是希望说这个人做出了一个侵害别人的行为之后、哦、那他是不是能够对这个被害人能够有所补偿、哦、这个其实也是我们所非常关注的一个点。因为现行的台湾这个死刑的制度呢，他除了这个判决死刑，然后把这个收容人关到这个看守所里面去之外，这个被判决死刑的人他不可以到工厂，到监狱的工厂里面去做工作。那这个是非常的这个不好的制度、哦、因为你必须要到工厂里面去工作的话，到监狱的工厂，因为台湾的监狱都有工厂，你到监狱去工作之后你才能够赚取这些工作金。那你赚取这些工作金，你才能够去赔偿这个被害人的损害。所以其实你说、哦、这个其实在律师所从事的这一些、哦、这个杀人案件里面，不管你是担任被告的律师，或者是担任被害人的律师、哦、担任被害者家属的律师，其实大家所思考的最重要的一个侧重点、哦、其实是在于说这一些这个被害人、哦、被害人已经死了嘛，那被害人死了之后，被害人的家属，他的太太，被害人死了，那他的太太，然后还有他的孩子要怎么办、哦、这个事情是大家最侧重的 点是在这里。所以如果说你用终身监禁、哦、的制度的话，让这个犯下错误的人，让被告、哦、他能够在监狱里面然后去彻底的反省，并且在往后的比如说30年50年的这个时间里面，然后到这个监狱的工厂里面工作，并且以他的工作去赔偿被害人的损害，这应该是一个比较、哦、这个恰当的一个方式，而不是说今天这个事情就是用死刑来解决。那用死刑来解决的话，这个被害人的家属他跟他所遗留下来的这个他的太太或者他的小孩还是没有办法得到填补啊，对不对、哦、所以应该是这个方式是一个可以有一个理性的方向去思考的方向才对、哦、好，以上就先简单说明到这里，谢谢大家。
Thank you very much, Mr. Chu, for the sharing from a different perspective. Since we have YB Kasthuri back here with us, so I think we can let Mr. YB Kasthuri to continue her sharing session.
Okay, thank you so much, Ira. I apologize to everyone for this technical gaffe. I don't know how many minutes do I have. I don't want to eat into anyone's time.
Maybe we can have you can have another 10 minutes, then we can open for Q&A session.
Okay, all right, thank you. So perhaps I'll touch on what is happening today. As we know that a continuation from 2018, so the then late Minister of Law, V.K. Liu, he signed a document of a moratorium on executions. So for those who don't know, in Malaysia, we have 33 offences that warrant the death penalty, of which 11 are mandatory death penalty, which means there's no discretion given to courts and to judges if they want to not use the death penalty as a form of a punishment. And of these 11, 9 come from the Penal Code, and 2 are from the Firearms Act. The rest of the balance, 20 over odd offenses, range very widely from kidnapping, from polluting a water source, waging war against the king, terrorism, etc. And over the years, we have also seen that every time there is a violent crime, like a violent murder especially, it is sensationalized by the media, giving a lot of details about the crime committed. And it is the way that the media has portrayed the case often allows readers to immediately invoke the death penalty on the person who has been detained, especially when it comes to violent crimes on children, rape, etc. And as what Sinyi had rightfully also pointed out, that often when surveys and polls are conducted after this sort of murders, you find that this enormous anger of the public in calling for the death penalty to be used. But two very near examples that I'm going to give you that have happened in also very near period of time. Last month, a single mother of 9 children was charged with drug trafficking in Malaysia. And drug trafficking actually is one of the offences that has been removed off the mandatory list in 2017. But unfortunately, because Malaysia uses the Singapore model, which is the person who is convicted must then prove that they have leads into where they got the obtained the drug from, and whether, you know, they can give other names and they can produce other so-called suspects or witnesses, etc. Until and unless you can produce that, then we are, in other words, we are back to status quo or in the past of drug-related offences, particularly trafficking, given the mandatory death penalty. So this poor single mother, a mother of 9 children, was charged with trafficking drugs, was given the death penalty. And there was this viral video of her in court after being given this verdict, crying and wailing out, you know, in sorrow, so much of anguish, so much of pain in her heart. And that just stirred the emotion on social media of people saying, oh, come on, you know, like, are we not going to get the persons who put the drugs on her? Are we not going to get the drug lords? Are we not going to get the syndicates? Why are we going after the small fish when you have sharks out there? And that sort of gave a different feel to it. You know, there was a lot of sympathy, a lot of empathy as well with this case. And then of late, you must have read the case of Nagendran, a mentally disabled Malaysian who is on death row in Singapore. He's been on death row for 10 years, also for drug-related offences. His charge was that he trafficked 42 grams of heroin into Singapore. Despite having an IQ, despite being obviously stated that he has an IQ of 69, the Singaporean government still adamant that he knew what he was doing at that time. That case also has brought about a lot of conversation on the death penalty, but then it was more of a compassion, mercy sort of a conversation. But again, I've also found that it is also the way that the media reports this. Some of us MPs have been reaching out to ministers, reaching out to even I had the opportunity to meet the Prime Minister last Wednesday. It was just by chance he was in Parliament having a series of meetings. I took ADPAN's memorandum together with a picture of Nagendran and a report of his psychiatric analysis, a clinical assessment also, to hand over to the Prime Minister myself. So when I went to give it to the Malaysian Prime Minister, he seemed to know a little bit about the case. And he asked me what was his offence. I said, trafficking, drug-related. And he said, oh, you know, Singapore is tough on it. And I said, Mr. Prime Minister, we're not talking about the offence that he had committed, but now it is your intervention as Prime Minister to seek for mercy and compassion, not to execute a mentally disabled man. Having said that, the media then reported as
me asking the Prime Minister to intervene to stop the execution of a man charged for drug trafficking. So you can imagine the sort of public reaction. And it is also the language, you know. And this was reported in Malay, which is the national language of the country. And all the comments that came there were, oh, if he knew it was an offense, why did he still do it? If he knew that that Singapore had the death penalty on this, and he knew Singapore is just not even tolerant on chewing gum, let alone drugs being brought into the country, etc. And I tried to explain, especially on Instagram, because the news was carried in Instagram, but it was just sort of a... You just couldn't get through to them, you know. Their minds were already set. If you knew, then why did you do it? Now that it's done, and then they played the race card a little bit because the man who was on death row is Indian and I'm Indian, etc. So the subject on the death penalty can very quickly take a turn for the worse, until and unless you package the story properly, as I had mentioned earlier. Today, I believe that through some of my conversations with the current law minister, who was a former police officer, and then later on, I believe he read law, and he told me that back in 1978, when he was a student applying to study law, there was a assessment requirement. Students were required to write in an essay on what they would like to see change or reforms with the law, etc. And he wrote on the death penalty from an abolitionist point of view, and why the death penalty won't work, how it is always discriminately used against the minorities, etc. And he told me, so, you know, since I used this was my subject in 1978 that I wrote about, you know, so, yeah, he gave me the impression that he had his heart in the right place. And I hope to see the first step to, I believe, a long journey to abolish the death penalty in Malaysia in its entirety must begin with abolishing the mandatory death penalty first to accord discretion to the court. But thank God for that document on the moratorium. We have not had any executions in Malaysia since. And I believe that there's also a growing call for the government, especially when we give them data such as more than 86% of people on death row in Malaysia come from challenged, very low socioeconomic status. And it sort of gives people, you know, it's a bit of an eye-opener sort of a statement. Oh, is that so? And then you go on to explain to them, you know, when was the last time you actually saw a person who has an honorific title, you know, like in Malaysian context, a Tan Sri, Datuk Sri, you know, ever being, even if they are charged with the death penalty, actually going through and being placed in the cell together with all the other death row inmates. When was the last we ever heard that? You know, so that sort of gets them talking about it. But that was also my personal experience. I think it was 2016. It was a double execution that happened in Malaysia of the Batu Malay brothers. In Malaysia, executions normally happen on Fridays, just before the Friday prayers in the morning. And we had news that the Batu Malay brothers were going to be executed on Wednesday. And it just, you know, it was shocking to all of us. Why was there a sudden rush to execute these brothers? Because there was a growing call of international support and pressure, you know, and the story was being highlighted all over the world on social media, you know, especially when there's discrepancies in the case itself. I read the judgment, and even me who don't come from a legal background, had questions about where these evidences were and etc. So the night before they were executed, there was a candlelight vigil outside the prison. We had members of civil society there, lawyers, and the family of the brothers. And I looked at it was drizzling, so all of us were holding our candles in a bit of a light drizzle or rain. And I observed all the cars that were parked by the roadside heading towards the prison, and found that it was, you know, generally Malaysian made cars, you know, Myvi's, Kanchils. I didn't see BMWs and I didn't see Volvos. I didn't see Range Rovers, Mercedes-Benz and expensive cars parked by the roadside. And I looked at the family members and they were just dressed in their regular, you know, home clothes rather, if you want to call it, for lack of a better word. You know, I didn't see men and women in expensive suits and ties and coats standing by the roadside at night, you know, in the rain, pleading to the government not to execute their children. Now, any crime committed must be punished. That's be very clear on it. And these are the things that the retentionists often say. Oh, you know, would you like to see murderers walking in the housing area? Would you like to see murderers walking in the streets with, you know, with so that they can allow, they're allowed to commit another murder again, etc. And these are the things that often also triggers that emotional reaction by the public, that fear, you know. But abolitionist means that we want to see an end to the death penalty. Not that crime is not addressed, not that criminals are not punished, you know, and then it dawned to me that it was very much a law, very much an act of used by the government to punish the minority group. You often hear, you know, unemployed person, lorry driver, factory worker, odd job worker, contract worker, electrician, wiring man, you know, never, very rarely, almost never, tycoons of big companies, etc., you know. And I refuse to be a part of a system that continues to punish the minorities. Governments should be investing in fighting crime. In the 80s, Malaysia was one of the countries that was part of the Golden Triangle in ASEAN, which was the hub for drug trafficking to the rest of the region and the world. And we've come, you know, almost 40 years after that, we're still dealing with the drug menace. So have we done enough to fight this, to counter this? Have we invested enough to counter this? But and yet we still keep executing people for this. And over the years in Malaysia, the number of people on death row has increased, particularly on drug-related offences that makes up the bulk of people on death row in Malaysian prisons. 75% of people on death row are in for drug-related offences in Malaysia. Next would be murder, then kidnap, etc. You know, so the governments cannot be taking the easy way out and executing people when your system is broken and you're not investing to fix this system to ensure that kids don't drop out of school and be part of triads and gangs, to ensure that men and women are given opportunities to climb the social ladder in their lives, to ensure that we eradicate poverty. You know, many of these drug mules, the biggest reason behind why they do this, commit this crime, coerced, assaulted and forced to do it, and no way out is poverty. And you know, it is a huge social problem. So you can't talk about the death penalty without talking about fixing social problems. You can't talk about the death penalty without ensuring that no children drop out of school. You can't talk about death penalty without ensuring there's gender, the conversation of gender in it as well. How many women are on death row? You know, that's always a very elusive number. But through a parliamentary reply I received last year, Malaysia makes up 16% of the global number of women on death row. What are their stories? How did they end up in prison? We don't know. So I think it's excellent that ADPAN, together with our friends and colleagues in Taiwan, have opened the platform, or rather, you know, triggered this conversation also now. It's very timely, particularly that the Malaysian Prime Minister has spoken about the Malaysian family, which is what I told him. I said, Nagendran is part of the Malaysian family, Mr. Prime Minister. You have to intervene. It's not interference, but to intervene for one of your members of your Malaysian family on death row in Singapore. But I applaud everyone who has been talking about this subject. I think we often find ourselves alone among our peers when we speak about it. Even civil society, even lawmakers, and even non-governmental individuals. It's not a very mainstream subject. It's not a very, very, I would say, a sexy subject, lack of a better word. You know, but I think we need to speak about all the external issues surrounding the death penalty, apart from the crime that is committed. I'm sure you and I, and many of us here today on this platform, have never been in for charged under, have never been on death row. Why? Because of the circumstances of how we were raised, our families, choices in life, opportunities that we have had, etc. But why were they, why did they do what they did and that resulted to where they are today? You know, it is lack of opportunities, I believe. Honorable Chu also very interestingly pointed out that a country that has a much larger population like Germany and how many people on death row and in prison, they don't have the death penalty in prison. Compared to Malaysia, we have about 32 million people and we have 67 people in prison and over 1,300 people on death row. I think those are very alarming statistics to look at. So I thank everyone for your time. I apologize for the technical gaffe just now. And I look forward to hearing from all of you all and to take any questions if there are. Thank you.
Thank you so much, YB Kasthuri, for such a very informative and good sharing session. Is there anything that Xinyi, you would like to add anything? Okay, so I'll open the floor for any questions. You may use the hand raise symbol, or you can just type in the chat box, or you can switch on your mic and ask directly if you have any question.
那可是很多民意就会出来攻击这些过去他们知道这些立法委员候选人他们是支持废死的，他们就会攻击他们。那也有，但是有一些立法委员的候选人，他们是用他们要有死刑，要立即执行死刑作为他们的竞选政见。好，可是你看到最后的结果是什么？最后的结果是那些说要死刑的这些立委候选人都没有当选。好，那这些过去有支持过废除死刑的立委都当选了。那我会觉得你可以看到一件事情，就是可能一般民众他们最在意的还是民生的议题。那以台湾来讲，可能是两岸的问题，国防安全的议题是很重要的。那死刑可能会是一个很激烈的辩论，可是当你最后投票的时候，它并不会是主要影响你投票的一个结果。所以我们都尝试着让立法委员更勇敢，因为我们有机会跟一些立法委员私底下讨论的时候，他们是支持废除死刑的，可是他们不敢为这件事情可能多说一点。那这就是我们目前的困境。那我不晓得在马来西亚，就是如果要去说服立法国会议员的话，那困境到底会是什么？当然我相信选举是一回事，可是真正来讲，如果以台湾的状况来讲，我就说并不会是关键因素的状态之下的话，我们还可以做一点什么样的努力？
Thank you, Xinyi. We have one question in the chat box from Dobby. Has there been any interparliamentary discussion or collaboration on the death penalty between Malaysia and Taiwan or with other Asian countries? Andrew Koo has replied, I don't think between Malaysia there's due to no official diplomatic relations. So maybe Legislator Chu or maybe Kasthuri wants to answer this question.
刚刚心仪的问题是不是是要问 Kasthuri 嘛、哦、就是说这个在马来西亚的这个状况这样。那我先补充一下，我刚刚、哦、有想要讲一个部分，就是说 有一些支持死刑的这个言论、哦、他都会讲说，那如果你的家人、啊哦、受到杀害的话、哦，那你会不会想要去把这个犯罪行为人杀死啊、哦、类似这样的提问就对。那刚好就是我在最近、哦、有帮，就是说有，因为这个台湾的国会议员可以去看守，去监狱或看守所进行一个叫做特见、哦、那我带了两个孩子去看，再去看一个台湾南部的一个这个看守所的被告。那这个状况就是说，这个男生啊、哦、杀死了这个太太、哦、就是说爸爸杀死了妈妈这样子。那律师呢就想要了解说，那到底这个孩子的真实的想法是什么、哦、那所以我就跟着律师还有这两个孩子一同进入到看守所去看这个爸爸、哦、那你可以想到就是说，有很多社会上或者是说一些人认为说，那这个就是一个杀人犯、哦、那这个丈夫杀死了太太，爸爸杀死了妈妈，所以那剩下两个孩子嘛、哦、那所以呢，如果你用过去那种想法的话，杀人者死，你就应该要杀人偿命嘛、哦、但是呢，当我带着这两个孩子去看他的爸爸的时候，你会看到说，其实这个孩子、啊、跟他爸爸的关系基本上他们就像一般的这种 小朋友跟爸爸之间的关系、哦、那你进一步去观察，你就会发现说，哇，糟糕了，现在我们面对一个问题，就是说爸爸杀死了妈妈、哦、那 这个国家这个审判系统到底要不要再因为这个案件而再杀死这个爸爸，然后让这两个小朋友从此成为一个无父无母的人，这个状况，所以我觉得在个案的状况这是非常复杂的啦，我觉得并不是说当大家提出来是说过去的那种想法。 杀人者死，然后要一命抵一命的这个想法，而是说我们要思考是说那有没有一个能够比较周全的去处理在这样的一个刑事案件发生之后，那有没有一个更好的一个解决问题的模式，这个是我想要补充的。那个案的类型，像我刚刚讲的那个那种类型，是也是一种杀人案件的类型，那究竟我们要如何来 面对，这个应该是说大家可以去进一步思考的，以上。Thank
you, Legislator Chiu. Why because we do you want to address the question that raised by Dobby in the chat box?
Okay, sure. Thanks, Sarah. It's very interesting what Honorable Chow has shared just now. That he had access to bring children to meet prisoners on death row. I don't think it is that easy in Malaysia for even MPs to request to visit prisoners on death row because I had asked before in the past and I didn't get an answer, and then when I pursued it, I sort of got a very negative reply that no, there's no reason, what is, you have to state your reason, etc. However, the human rights institution in Malaysia, Suhakam, are allowed to have access to visit these prisoners on death row, I believe, and they had done that in the past. With the question on do I believe in an eye for an eye, I think the answer is obvious, no. Often in Malaysia, we find, and perhaps in many cases around the world, you find that there is an underlying factor behind a person who commits this, what is seen as very heinous crime. And in Malaysia, many times you find that that in media reports, it is said that the person who committed the crime a day or two, etc., has been found to be positive for drugs, if it's not meth, something else. It makes you think that will the person have reacted this way if there was no other push factor behind it? And the push factor can come in many different forms. The state of your mental health, drugs, how you grew up, and all other circumstances. And even if you had been a child or a young person who had been abused terribly when you were growing up, I think there are many documentaries that have shown the backgrounds of all these people, whether they were serial killers or not, and how they come from very broken homes, and how they themselves have been victims of abuse, sexual abuse, psychological abuse, etc. And I think people at large, the man and the woman on the street, will always have this sentiment, this feeling that they believe that an eye for an eye is the only way to remedy the situation. But as a government, we're not talking about a corporate entity, we're not talking about a person who is being in business or an entrepreneur, we're talking government. It's another level of conversation. And while I strongly stand by the phrase of government that is for the people, by the people, and of the people, it is also the duty of the government to educate the people and raise an awareness, and not view abolitionist MPs and not view abolitionist NGIs or NGOs and CSOs as the enemy. And let's also be clear, no parliament in the world has had it easy when the government wanted to abolish the death penalty. Even today in France, conservative candidates who are running for election, etc., are proposing to bring back the death penalty. But at the end of the day, it is the right thing to do by a government in power. no matter how difficult it is. And you have to use all your resources, and resources are at the fingertips of governments, the media, the advertisements, yeah, government agencies, to be on board to share this government narrative. Today, after the Prime Minister announced about his Malaysia family or keluarga Malaysia concept, you have T-shirts, billboards, you know, every space on traditional media and online social media is being used to promote this keluarga Malaysia concept. So it is in the hands of the government to promote and to create an awareness on this, on human rights and the right to life. No, 30 years ago, if you had asked me, as a young person, I probably very much believed in an eye for an eye. But today, when you see these kind of things, when it happens, not to me, but when I look at cases that happen, you know, a direct involvement, looking at family members, etc., you know, I said, no, I cannot be a part of this system. I'm a taxpayer as well. I don't want my money to be used to execute people in my country. So that's just my little take on it. Thank you.
Thank you, YB Kasthuri. Yes, Xinyi, you have something else to add?
我想讲的事情是针对就是马来西亚跟台湾之间的国会议员的这个交流。那当然我们没有正式的外交关系，可是台湾跟很多国家都有实质的外交的一个交流。那前一阵子事实上欧盟议会的议员也来到台湾，或者是有一些其他国家的议员也来到台湾做交流，那台湾的国会议员也有机会。所以我会觉得虽然没有正式的外交关系，但是如果两个国家的这个国会议员可以互相交流的话也是很好的。那这也提醒我一件事情，就是说就我所知，就是日本跟韩国、南韩这两个国家也一直都有一群立委，他们是国会议员，他们是不间断的可能会提出比如说废除死刑的法案，或者是试着在国会上面推动。那我就会觉得或许我们应该跟那个 ADPAN 一起来思考一下，就是我们如何让例如台湾、马来西亚，然后日本、韩国的这个国会议员可以有一些交流，然后因为我相信我们的状况可能比较相近，然后我们彼此为彼此发声可能也会得到一些效果。那对，很感谢这个问题，因为我觉得让我想到可能以后的一些工作的一个可能性。对，谢谢。
Thank you, Xinyi. That was a great suggestion. Maybe we can work more on that together with ADPAN. Is there any other questions for our panelists? From anyone? Also, in the meantime, please help yourself to fill up the feedback form. The link was attached in the chat box before we end our session today. Is there any, maybe one last question from the floor? Yes, Xinyi? Oops, sorry. the symbol hand raise was on just now. Okay, so yeah, any other questions? So I guess that would be a wrap up for our forum session today. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much, especially to our panelists, Legislator Q and YB Kasthuri, for joining us for spending weekends to talk on our forum. And also thank you, Xinyi, for this opportunity. And thank you, everyone, for joining. Thank you, everyone. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Jiayou.
Jiayou. 谢谢.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Stay safe.